A small nation it may be, but this is the story of one of Wales' undoubted great men. A man who emerged from the grey grime of the Rhondda to light up the world with his sporting prowess and to captivate millions with the sound of his voice.
Here goes Cliff Morgan. A superb drive that makes it 14-3.
This is Gareth Edwards! A dramatic start! Welsh goal!
What would you have given Richard for a Welsh cap?
I would rather have played for Wales than play Hamlet.
He's one of my heroes, and one of my very few heroes, actually. And he was magnificent. I loved him then, and I love him today.
Clifford Isaac Morgan was born on the 7th of April 1930 in the Rhondda village of Trebannog, the son of Cliff Morgan, a miner, and Edna, a housewife. Many boys of Cliff's age might have expected to have followed their fathers down the pit, but Cliff's abilities, both sporting and intellectual, marked him out for brighter things. Even as a pupil of Tony Revail Grammar School, his talent on the rugby field was clear to see. And that talent gave him his ticket out of the Rhondda into the city and the bright lights of Cardiff. For in the summer of 1949, the young Cliff Morgan left his grammar school 15 and steamed into Cardiff RFC, where he would soon carve a name for himself. A bright young man, he had a place at Cardiff University to study chemistry, but it was at the Arms Park that Cliff first discovered the formula for try-scoring success. There, he was in distinguished company, including the Prince of Centres, Bleddyn Williams.
Having left Tonrevel Grammar School, I understand where Ned Gribble, who was the teacher there, and of course the coach, although he probably wasn't known as a coach in those days, and he was a believer in classical rugby, and the ball should always be moved to the wing as quickly as possible. And he forbid Cliff to kick out of hand and drop goals and this, that and the other, you see. So Cliff wasn't overt for this when he came and joined us, but he soon learned, you see.
At Cardiff, the apprentice outside half learnt the kind of sorcery that would delight many thousands of fans. But first, he had to prove himself among the rags.
Most people, you see, who came into the club, they had to play for the rags, first of all, the second team, as you know, Cardiff's second team. But at one time in that stage, you know, they had about 10 internationals in the rag side. But it was always a policy that if they came in, they had to play. But he soon settled in, and he was a joy to play with, I must say. But his strength always was the speed off the mark, you see, and that's how we used to avoid the wing forwards and the outside halves from that point of view. He wasn't a mover like Barry John or Phil Bennett and this, that, this way. He was a straight runner, you see.
So the tuneful voice of Wales welcomed the All Blacks to Cardiff, a heartfelt greeting from over 50,000 fans who packed the Arms Park. Cardiff, the home side, have a proud record against touring sides, though with the New Zealanders on the warpath, a real battle royal was promised.
By 1953, Cliff had moved from the rags to the riches of Cardiff's first team. And one day in November, they got the chance to prove their mettle. Undaunted by the New Zealanders' undefeated record, the Cardiff boys were soon to choreograph a war dance of their own. Right from the start, they played with passion and commitment.
Within 8 minutes, Cardiff were on the attack with Thomas sending Rowlands away on the wing. A kick ahead was followed up strongly, and from a scramble near the line, Judd made the touchdown.
The last whistle confirmed the incredible, an 8-3 victory.
The Cardiff pack, which didn't have a very good reputation going into that game, were absolutely outstanding. And Cliff and Rex Willis at scrum half, of course, were absolutely magnificent on the day.
The taste of victory whetted the appetite for more. 3 weeks later, Cliff faced the All Blacks yet again, only this time wearing the red jersey and not the blue and black. His Cardiff captain, Bleddyn Williams, led the Welsh national side to a sensational victory. Ken Jones scored the winning try, but Wales would never again defeat the All Blacks. Cliff had come of age both as a man and as a player in 1951, when he represented the land of his fathers for the very first time.
But here's the chance. Thomas passes to Ken Jones and he's away like a flash. They won't catch him this time. It's a try all over.
And in only his second season of international rugby, the outside half had already become a major weapon in his team's epic battles to secure the Grand Slam. And like all Grand Slammers, he became one of the heroes of the hour. A formidable player on the pitch, Cliff commanded the respect of his opponents and was ultimately rewarded with their lifelong friendship.
Well, of course, I saw him play before I met him. I saw him play in 1952 in Dublin for Wales. And I thought he was just electrifying that day. He had that wonderful sort of darting quality about him. But the thing I remember about that match particularly was a wonderful outside break and then inside pass, which set Ken Jones on a searing 50-yard run, which ended in a try and ended Ireland's hopes of winning. And I thought, what a player, what a player.
And the crowd sees some brilliant play by Lloyd Williams at scrum half and Cliff Morgan at standoff, who get the ball neatly away from the scrum time and time again.
Cliff matured into one of the greatest players, not just in Wales, but in Britain, arguably the world. Sidestepping, jinking, weaving. Even now, through the grain of archive film, his movement with the ball is pure poetry. In 1954, Wales took on Scotland at St. Helens. For Cliff, it was a first. The first time he scored a try, sealing victory for Wales. It was a foretaste of things to come.
I played against him in my first Welsh international in Wales in 1955. I was just 18 at the time, marking Bledon Williams, actually. And Cliff scored a startling try that day.
Wales kick off against Ireland at Cardiff Arms Park. The local lads are given an extra spur in this match by the fact that it's the 75th birthday of the Welsh Rugby Union. So 11-3 is the score, but not for long. Here goes Cliff Morgan. A superb try that makes it 14-3.
We were demolished, but five of us got on the Lions tour afterwards, and that was all we cared about, going on the Lions tour.
That tour in 1955 to South Africa was the first since before the war. And here, Cliff, brought up in the Welsh choral tradition, used his musical talents to rally popular support.
The thing we're going to learn, he said, is the South African national anthem, Sari Mare. So we formed the choir and we learned the words in Afrikaans. And we arrived in Jan Smuts Airport. 2 days later, 10,000 people to greet us. We formed up on the runway when we got off the plane into a choir. And I can still hear us sing the opening words of Sari Mare, May Sari Mare, he so far from me af, Mari hoopam har, vier ti sing. And you know, it was the PR gesture of the century because all South Africa fell in love with us. And as Cliff had predicted, we were the team of that year. And it changed, we in a sense, and Cliff particularly, changed South African perception of rugby as a game of attrition, a game of warfare, into a game where glittering backs could be released by good forwards.
The visitors staged a remarkable effort. It started with Cliff Morgan knifing his way through the defence for a try. Cameron converted, and the Lions had regained the lead by 13 points to 11.
He was a man apart. He was the team. He was the captain. He was the choir leader. He was the voice of the team, the musician, the pianist. When he played well, we played well.
And a terrific strain from the skate takes the deciding kick. It goes astray, and the British Isles have won the first test by 23 points to 22. A great victory and a great game.
The South Africans had a blitz defence in those days. And in fact, rather like the defence they have today. And Cliff would always say, put it over the top, lads, put it over the top. And we'd sort of run on in these very hard grounds onto the ball. And that pushed them back a little, gave us room to move. And from then on, it was follow Morgan. If you could get near him, you could have a good chance of scoring.
Now leading by 6 points to nil, the Lions go on the rampage. Morgan to O'Reilly. O'Reilly is tackled and his high pass is forward. Try this aloud. But in actual fact, the Lions brought their tally to 9 with an unconverted try soon afterwards.
He was like some sort of electric mouse. he sort of darted here, there, and everything. And so if you could follow him, you would suddenly find yourself in open space. And that is what rugby's about, open space.
Wales in the squared numbers kick off against Ireland at Lansdowne Road, Dublin. And within
Morgan the Magnificent, as he was dubbed, became captain of Wales in 1956. Inside his own half. That's a blow. 2 years later, he was playing his last season of rugby ever, but continued to inspire his teammates to some classic performances, right up to this, his last ever game.
Lift Morgan again. He passes to Davis. Davis to Nichols, but O'Reilly brings him down and the ball's loose. Hagen Morgan has it. Noel Henderson gets it away, but Cliff Morgan's there. Tony O'Reilly tackles, but Cliff gets it away to Hayden Morgan, and he's over. Victory for Wales, 5 minutes from time.
Glorious end to a glorious career. But when Cliff hung up his boots for the last time, you might have expected him to disappear from the public eye. Not Cliff, though. During Cliff's playing career, broadcasting, and television in particular, was fast expanding in Wales. With their lightweight equipment and informal dress code, these men were really going places, especially if the road was wide enough. Soon, Cliff would be joining them and would become lifelong friends with a certain outside broadcast director, the youthful Doughy Griffiths.
Most people decided that Cliff was a rugby player with a bit of flair. But we had a man here in the BBC called Howell Davis who said, there's more to Cliff Morgan than just a rugby player. And he went on to prove it.
Well, first of all, since nobody else has had a chance to say so, welcome home to you, Cliff, to Wales and to Welsh Sports Parade.
Howell Davis offered Cliff the chance to get behind the cameras and microphones and present his own programmes. And Cliff, who up to then had worked in industry, just couldn't refuse. He enthusiastically took up the challenge, sometimes literally learning his craft, at the coalface.
Howell Davis decided what was missing more than anything was a real sports department. And he decided to appoint Cliff Morgan as the sports organiser. Now, he wanted someone to look after his television programme. See, Cliff was brilliant. He was inventive. He was good with contacts. He was good with contracts. He was the right sort of man. He had the right charm to get connections with the sporting world outside. And, of course, they loved being involved. And Howell Davis invited me to become part of Cliff's operation. So there were two of us in the first ever BBC Wales television sports department.
Long before the term multitasking had been invented, Cliff was doubling as producer and presenter.
Introduced by Cliff Morgan.
And I have to ask Mr. David Cole now to come along and present this £100 cheque to the person, the winning reader in the Western Mill competition, who picked these top 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Cliff's easy microphone manner always managed to get the best out of his interviewees. This was his very first.
Oh, Bill, now we'd been looking well right through the game, and this old friend Carey was opposite me, and he was putting his hand over old Billy Gore's eyes, and I thought only old Maldwyn James had those things, but anyway, I went to withdraw his hand, and he bit me right on the finger, so his ear was quite near, so I had a good bite of that.
BBC Television, 1 o'clock.
Yes, for millions of TV viewers, that was the sound of a Saturday afternoon, a sound that would soon be complemented by the voice of Cliff Morgan, who was to join the programme as a contributor, while the young Paul Fox was its editor.
My earliest memory of Cliff is on a Saturday evening, the first night of a programme called Sports Special, introduced by David Coleman, and it was a programme that had everything in it, full of football and other people. And the people who turned up included Reg Harris, a cyclist, Frank Swift, the footballer, Henry Rose, the journalist. And suddenly, in the midst of all this chaos, came a quiet little man at the side of the set, Cliff Morgan, whom I had never met before. And he brought this beautiful girl along with him, Nuala, who then became his first wife. And Cliff, I mean, I think we were overrunning by over an hour or something, and Cliff finally came on. And when one heard him speak, of course, one realized one was in the presence of a star.
That star was allowed to shine on programmes such as Sports View, hosted by the very dapper Peter Dimmock.
When he came to London, he was received with open arms. I think there was some resentment, perhaps. I mean, here, one has to remember, here was the first time somebody had come in who hadn't come in the traditional route. And this was the first time, really, we had somebody who'd been a star in one particular sport coming into television. Words mattered enormously to Cliff, and Cliff cared for the words and cared for the way they were voiced and the way the commentary was done. And I think that that was his major contribution. I don't think people have recognized how much he contributed to the well-spoken commentary, to the well-thought-out phrase. And I don't think it happens all that much these days, but in Cliff's time, commentators had to watch their words because they knew if they didn't do their job properly, Cliff would be after them.
By 1968, Cliff had abandoned the office routine to become a freelance rugby commentator. And in that year, he found himself a real lion of a man as they toured South Africa. One player in particular had caught his eye, the young Gareth Edwards.
There was relatively few people on the tour then, and they were well known by the players, and indeed, everything we did, we encouraged them to be on board. Cliff was a piano player. He was still very, very funny, always popular with the players and everybody else for that matter.
Opposite stag is Dupre, Frick Dupre. That's jumping in straight across there. Across the line.
Although the Lions succumbed to the pressure of the South Africans, Cliff recognised early on that he was commentating on some players of truly outstanding talent.
Sail on the sloop, John B, my grandpa.
By 1971, the Lions boasted one of the greatest sides ever to leave these shores, which they did in June of that year to take on the might of New Zealand. The names of Wales' greatest players were already becoming associated with the name of the match commentator, Cliff Morgan.
He's got two and outside. Gibson's with him. Gibson's got Gerald Davis. Can he get there? He's got 25 yards to go. What a run it is. He's going under the sticks.
Taylor's deflection. Edwards is nearly under the post. Can he get there? To Barry John, and Barry John has scored. What a try.
John Williams, the fullback. Oh, he turned well, and he did it. And that's it. That's it. A drawn match here, 14 points all at Eden Park. But the British Lions have won the series.
The Lions' magnificent performance was but the prelude to a game featuring one of the greatest tries and one of the greatest commentaries in the annals of sports broadcasting. The 1973 match between the Barbarians and the All Blacks, when the visitors were looking for revenge. Few were surprised to see stellar talents like JPR, Phil Bennett and Gareth Edwards emerging from the tunnel. Few were surprised to see the New Zealand haka. But the choice of match commentator was a surprise, not least to Cliff Morgan himself.
First and foremost, I didn't realise that Cliff was going to be commentating, because very few people knew, and still know to this day, that Bill McLaren was earmarked for that and went down with a virus or with flu or what have you. Just before the game, and I think they had to go and find Cliff at some function he was attending.
I can remember planning it for Bill McLaren. I think his name is in the Radio Times as well, but I'm not terribly sure about that. And then next thing I knew, it was because it was a Barbarians match. I must say, in deference to wonderful people like Peter Dimmock, that rugby wasn't a great game as far as London BBC was concerned. It was a pretty interesting schoolboy game in a way to them, whereas it was, you know, one of the gifts of heaven for us.
This is Gareth Edwards!
He just showed his ability as a man of words to be able to describe a moment so aptly. It would have been interesting to hear what Bill McLaren might have said about it. Suffice to say, we're left with Cliff's gems, really, of saying the right thing, never too much, never too little, just the right thing at the right time. When he says, oh, brilliant, oh, because he actually, he's living it, he's playing it, isn't it? The ball is in his hands, he's actually telling everybody what he would be doing. That is what I think comes over more than anything else.
Almost on the halfway line, Kirkpatrick to Williams. This is great stuff. Phil Bennett covering. Chased by Alistair Scull. Brilliant. Oh, that's brilliant. John Williams, Brian Williams, pulling. John Dawes. Great dummy. It's David, Tom David, the halfway line. Brilliant by Quinnell. This is Gareth Edwards, a dramatic start. What a score! Oh, that fellow Edwards. If the greatest writer of the written word would have written that story, no one would have believed it.
We enjoyed that fact that we're part of what has been rugby history, and I suppose what both of us would have wished is that we would have had a royalty, him on the commentary and me on the film.
Rugby wasn't the only sport where Messrs Edwards and Morgan got together, and Cliff could always encourage a great quote.
I was fortunate enough to do a very famous television interview with him in the middle of the Usk River many, many years ago, which people still talk to me about it. They, you know, there are certain things that people remember. They ask me, do you remember that time you were fishing with Cliff Morgan? And you said...
To me, it's the ultimate in happiness.
Most of them scoring a try for Wales, can I?
Well, I've scored enough tries for Wales. I don't catch enough salmon, or that's a trouble.
Cliff later approached the celebrity couple of Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor, and he secured an astonishing admission from the rugby-mad thespian. There was one role he would love to have played.
I have a Blevins autobiography, and it automatically opens at page 37 because he says that if I hadn't fallen for the lure of tinsel and paint and so on, I might have made a very nippy wing forward for Wales. However, I think he was being over-generous.
But listen, what would you have given, Richard, for a Welsh cap?
I would rather have played for Wales than play Hamlet. And I played Hamlet twice, reasonably successfully, both in Great Britain and the United States. I just won match, but never happened. And certainly never will now, unless it's like for the over 40s or something.
Welcome once again to A Question of Sport.
For all his achievements in rugby, though, it was possibly this programme more than anything else in his life that made Cliff a household name throughout Britain. It was also at this time that Cliff became a BBC executive.
People forget, actually, Cliff's involvement as head of outside broadcasts. I mean, he had a major role in producing such big events as Lord Mountbatten's funeral. I mean, it was a major state funeral, the royal wedding, and the state occasion was a thing for Cliff because, again, he cared for the words. He cared for the good phrase, for the good paragraph, and that's what mattered with Cliff.
But people mattered to Cliff just as much as mere words. And in 1980, he was instrumental in bringing the cause of disabled athletics to the public's attention. As somebody who'd suffered a stroke himself earlier, he well knew how disability could change one's life. He knew also the power of TV to bring a neglected area of sport into the mainstream. Whether as a sportsman or as a broadcaster, Cliff's easy, polite manner made him a firm favourite with the royal family, so much so that the Queen recommended him for the CVO, Commander of the Royal Victorian Order.
Cliff did contribute something special to sport on television and on radio. Let's not forget the 15-minute programme he used to do on a Saturday morning on Radio 4.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the programme in which we meet Tony Jacklin and Jack Nicklaus, the rival Ryder Cup captains.
Cliff had that wonderful quality in his voice. His eloquence matched with his cadence made him absolutely definable. And Radio 4 on a Saturday morning with Cliff was just something a great number of people waited for. Cliff's weekly commune with the people who adored him.
He's one of my heroes, and one of my very few heroes, actually. And he was a great guide, a great instructor as a broadcaster. I mean, I had to have the rough bits knocked off me, and he did it very well. And I admired the way he told me. And he didn't hang back in his criticism ever. He would tell you the truth. But you took it from Cliff because he'd done it himself. He had that magnificent instrument, his own voice. And he was a great broadcaster in both mediums, you know, radio and television. So when he told you something, it stayed told. And he was magnificent. I loved him then and I love him today. Sadly, we will never hear Cliff broadcast again. Illness has deprived him of that magnificent voice, one of the best broadcasting voices of all time. Here's a reminder of Cliff, though, in top form.
You look at me and think I'm structured of Welsh culloddens and Welsh myths and Welsh geography, the shape of me, and my accent, you will understand that I am Welsh. I come from a country where the sun never sets. That's because God doesn't trust the buggers in the dark. I'm a man who played a bit of rugby occasionally, which is the absolute combination of opera, ballet, and murder. And I played so long ago that we thought a coach was a posh bus.
Well, Cliff has been a great rugby player. He was an outstanding broadcaster. But possibly more important than anything, he is a great man.
He is the greatest, kindest, most thoughtful person you could wish to meet, with a love of language and a love of words and a love of music, and he's absolutely the chap you'd want to go in the jungle with.
He is a man apart. He's a man apart because of his gaiety, because of his grandeur, because of his eloquence, because of his skills, obviously, as a football player, because of his generosity to his other players, which is enormous. He was not a selfish man in life or on the field. To me, Cliff Morgan was simply the greatest of them all.
We were talking one day on tour, Englishman, Scotsman, Irishman, Welshman, trying to find the epitome of Englishness or Welshness or Scottishness. And O'Reilly leapt in my room, he says, "Moggs," he said, "I've got the epitome of Englishness," he said. I said, "What's that?" He said, "David Marks," he said, M-A-R-Q-U-E-S, of Cambridge University in England, actually. And David was 6'7", lying down. He was a bit too tall to measure standing up. And he was lying on the foot of a ruck on a wet day in Dunedin in New Zealand in a test match. And he was lying there, and a Maori forward called Albie Pryor came and tried to take his head off with his boot. There was blood all down his face, his scrumpock was pulled down like this. And, you know, all he did in retaliation was to shake this clown's hand. And Wiggs Mulcahy from Bective Rangers in Dublin, he looked down and he says, "What in the name of Jesus is wrong with you, Davey?" He said, "Why didn't you give the fellow a punch in the snot?" And David Marks stood up, sort of, 6'7" of quivering English rectitude, and he bestowed that look of condescension which the English have bestowed on the Irish for centuries. And he said, "You wouldn't understand, old boy. I wanted to make the fellow feel a cad."